A very good afternoon to all the esteemed dignitaries, respected deans and directors, my faculty colleagues and dear students. I, Dr. Anjali Shaukeen, take this privilege to extend a warm welcome to each one of you present here on the behalf of the Directorate of Student Welfare, Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University. Today, we are gathered here for the celebrations of 75 years of India's independence, that is Azadi Ka Amrut Mahotsav, and it is commencing 75 weeks prior to the Independence Day, that 2022, and it would extend up to Independence Day 2023. We will be launching the opening ceremony today from Gujarat. We need to maintain our unity for making our country strong, and in the memory of independence, I welcome you all to celebrate the evolution of our country from pre-independence era to post-independence era. We would like to formally begin the celebrations with our university Kulgeet, which encapsulates the essence of our knowledge. I request Vineet to please play the Kulgeet.
Okay, ma'am. लाएंगे हम सच का सवेरा, गुरु कृपा का होगा बसेरा, विद्या की लो और लगन से हट जाएगा यह दम घनेरा, इस तरह से आसमां तक हम बनाने जान गए, अपने श्रम से कौशलों से हम बढ़ाने मान महिमा, जाए अपनी सुगंध हर दिशा में, प्रगति पथ पर ख्याति अपनों को दबा में, अपनी उड़ान हम करेंगे सबका कल्याण, हम इंद्रप्रस्थ की अंजुमन, हम इंद्रप्रस्थ को करते नमन, पाले गुरु गोविंद सिंह की राग ज्ञान गंगा गगन, हट जाएगा ये दंग लेरा, सच का
कलेरा। थैंक यू विनीत फॉर प्लेइंग द इंस्पायरिंग कुलगीत ऑफ अवर यूनिवर्सिटी। बिफोर आई टेक the opportunity to formally invite Professor Manpreet Kaur Kang, Dean, University School of Humanities and Social Sciences, and Director, Student Welfare, to deliver the welcome address I would like to say a few words about ma'am. Professor Manpreet Kaur Kang holds a profound teaching experience of more than 25 years, and she is having the specialization.
So sorry to interrupt you. Let's just move ahead. It's a bit running short of time that's required. Thank you so very much. Thank you.
Okay, yeah. Ma'am. Okay. We welcome you, ma'am. We request you to please deliver the welcome address. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Anjali. Good afternoon, everyone. It is indeed my proud privilege to welcome everyone present here to this webinar, organized to celebrate the landmark event of 75 years of India's independence. I accord a very warm welcome to our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Padma Shri, Dr. Mahesh Verma, who's always so full of positive energy and, you know, motivates us always. We are very excited to have a wonderful panel of speakers with us today, all eminent personalities in their respective fields. I'm happy to welcome Ms. Swapna Liddle, who is an author and a convener of INTACT. We are really grateful to you, ma'am, that you have spared your valuable time despite other preoccupations today. We are waiting to hear from you. I also accord a very warm welcome to Lieutenant General G.S. Chindale, a decorated senior army officer who will share his experiences with us. I'm also very happy to welcome Professor Rizwan Kaiser, Professor of Modern Indian History, Department of History and Culture, Jamia Millia Islamia. We're looking forward to hear your expert views, sir. I'd like to welcome all the deans, directors, and officers of the university who are present here. I also warmly welcome my colleagues and dear students and all the staff members who have joined us today to celebrate this day, which is called Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav, this big celebration on the theme Evolution of India, Pre and Post Independence. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am, for your very warm welcome to all the dignitaries and the participants. A leader is one who sets a clear vision for the organization, motivates its students and staff to achieve great heights. Padma Shri Professor Dr. Mahesh Verma, Honorable Vice Chancellor, is an exceptional leader and a wonderful human being. Under his able leadership, our university is achieving greater heights and discovering new horizons. It would be indeed a privilege to say a few words about our visionary leader. Sir has served as director in Maulana Azad Medical Institute of Dental Sciences, and the institute was awarded as the best dental school in India. Sir is also actively involved in WHO social and community projects, as well as institutional projects of CSIR and ICMR. Sir is also serving on prestigious position of international advisor to the Royal College of Physicians and Surgeons of Glasgow, United Kingdom. Sir has received many honors and awards, like state awards from the government of NCT Delhi, prestigious Dr. B.C. Roy National Award in 2007, and from the President of India, and the highest civilian award, Padma Shri, in the year 2014. GDSIP University is continuously growing and shining under your able guidance, sir. We are blessed to have your continuous guidance and encouragement. You are truly an inspiration and source of energy for all of us. With these words, I would like to invite you, sir, for your valuable address. Over to you, sir.
Sir, we can't hear you, sir.
Vineet?
Yes,
that's Vineet, you have...
Yeah. Thank you, Anjali, as usual. For all the good words. Lieutenant General G.S. Chandale, can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You are.
Can I?
Thank you.
Yeah, can I request everybody either to switch off their videos, because I think we are working on a very small bandwidth and so many people are connected. Or I can stop my video. I can keep my video on and others can stop the video so that, you know, it doesn't drop down. Is it okay?
Right, sir. So our invited speakers can keep their video on and the rest of us will stop our videos.
Yeah. So, Honorable Lieutenant General G.S. Chandel, Ati Vishisht Seva Medal, Vishisht Seva Medal, Janab Professor Rizwan Kaiser Ji, Swapna Lidl, Manpreet Kang, our Director of Student Welfare, Associate Director Anjali Shokin, Gulshan Damija, our other deans of the school, faculty, staff members, ladies and gentlemen. As you all know that we recently got a communication from government and other regulatory bodies that India is celebrating Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav, and you know, we were so excited. All of us are very proud of our nation, and so today, this morning, Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav ka jo jashan hai, wo hamare Pradhanmantri ji ne subah Sabarmati Ashram Ahmedabad se shuru kiya, aur ek symbolic दंडी मार्च की यात्रा जो उन्होंने शुरू की, जो 241 किलोमीटर की लंबी यात्रा है, और वो जो 12 मार्च 1930 को हुआ था उसको एक रीएनैक्ट कर रहे हैं, ताकि एक सिंबल जाए, एक वो जो दंडी मात्रा का जो घटना थी, जो शायद स्वतंत्रता संग्राम की घटनाओं में से एक बहुत ही अद्भुत घटना थी जिसने स्वतंत्रता के सपने को साकार किया, और इस यात्रा के द्वारा गांधी जी ने अपने जो भी सत्याग्रही उनके साथी थे उनकी मदद से एक सत्य का एक ऐसा रास्ता जो है उन्होंने आविष्कार किया या फाउंड किया, जिससे जो पूरी जो अंग्रेजों की जो हुकूमत थी वो हक्की बक्की रह गई। इसे शायद ये कहना कि दंडी की नींव पर आजाद भारत का स्वप्न, इसमें कोई अतिशयोक्ति नहीं होगी, और ना ही ये कोई ऐसा कोई सिर्फ ये नमक का जो कानून उन दिनों में बना था उसको उसकी जो उसमें जो बहुत सारी जघन्य धाराएं थी उसका एक रेजिस्टेंस था, बट आई थिंक मैं ये भी कहूंगा कि इसमें बहुत ही गहरे जो निहितार थे, जो और सारी चीजें थी वो इसमें उसमें छुपी हुई थी, और एक ऐसी चिंगारी थी जिसने पूरे स्वतंत्रता आंदोलन की लौ को और प्रज्वलित किया और बढ़ाया, और जैसे कहते हैं ना कि आग में जो है घी की आहुति देना, उस तरह का ये एक ऐसा अनूठा एक एक घटना थी। और इस घटना को मद्दे रखते हुए भारत सरकार ने, हमारे देश ने इसको नाम दिया अमृत महोत्सव। तो जब हम कहते हैं अमृत, तो ये अमृत क्यों कहा गया, ऐसा क्यों कहा गया कि अमृत है, और अमृत होता क्या है? यू नो, हम सब जानते हैं कि अमृत का मतलब है नेक्टर या एक एलिक्सर, जो एक ऐसी चीज जो जैसे हम अगर ऋग्वेद में देखें तो ये एक ऐसा ये था ड्रिंक थी जो हमारे देवता लोग जो जिसको कंज्यूम करते थे। और आप सब जानते हैं कि शायद अमृत इसलिए कहा गया क्योंकि जो हमारी पूरे स्वतंत्रता आंदोलन की जो इंटरनल चर्निंग थी, उस चर्निंग से जो पूरा मंथन था, उस आजादी के मंथन से जो ये अमृत निकला, वो जो है इसी वजह से इसको अमृत महोत्सव कहा गया कि शायद ये पूरे आजादी के जो मंथन था उसमें से जो निष्कर्ष निकला उसी वजह से इसको हमने इसको अमृत महोत्सव का नाम दिया है। और हमारा जो आज का हमारा वेबिनार है, आज का जो ये हमारा सम्मेलन है, यू नो, वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट एवोल्यूशन ऑफ इंडिया, एंड यू नो दैट, यू नो, इफ यू लुक एट इंडियाज पास्ट, यू नो, वी स्टार्टेड our journey from a tribal system. If you look back 200-300 years back, India had just tribal system, and from there, how you know we have traveled so far. If you look at the early Vedic times, there were many tribes who elected their own chief and who handled all the responsibilities. So if you look at the governance, how it all started, then we had a time of Manu, and in the Manu's time, it was the first king and progenitor of mankind, which was given to the society. And if you look at Ramayana, look at Mahabharata later, you know, it only goes to portray the role of the king as a whole and soul of administration, which was held by his principal officer. So, ek administration ka jo avishkar hai, wo yahan se shuru hua. Aur un dino mein, we used to have purohits, we used to have senani, and phir Kautilya ka time aaya. Kautilya ne hume arth shastra diya, gave arth magic, and also gave us the system of Indian administration, you know, which was well developed. And then, if you look at those days, what was the economy? Economy was agriculture, which was the mainstay, and taxes on the goods produced as well as imports and exports were the source of revenue. It was only agriculture exchanges that that was economy source and exchange of economy between each other. Then we had Gupta's period, which carry forward Mauryan legacy of administration in many respects. Then came the Mughal administration, which was most organized and long lasting. I think it lasted for a long, long time, and carried till the modern, you know, modern times. And I think almost three centuries the Mughal administration lasted. And it was Akbar who was the architect of this system, because his grandfather and father, Babur and Humayun, they had their hands were full in battles and other socio-economic uncertainties, and they had very little time for as administrative activities, and which were finally refined and organized by Akbar. The policing system, how the policing is to be done, that was in the Mughals' time was entrusted to village headmen and kotwals of the cities and towns. And then we had an era of British Raj. In British Raj, as we all know, that the East India Company came to India with the sole objective of making profit through commercial exchanges. Basically, it was a company, but you know, from here on, we had Lord Cornwallis who developed the Civil Services Code. So he's, I think, father of a modern civil services. Then we had a revolt of 1857, which shook up the system and led to the end of British East India Company's a kind of rule in India since independence in 1947. You know, we have come a long way. So this was just a little glance at how, over many centuries, how India has progressed in terms of administration and organization. So today, our country is in a 21st century, and this is a century of knowledge, and we all stand at the cusp of a digital future. We have a 4.0 industrial revolution already, and we all know that India is one of the largest and the fastest growing economies of the world. And from very beginning of the written history till today, if there is one thread that binds India through all these different ages, is the fact that the story of India has been a composite of its people, its citizens. Perhaps the reason for discussion we are having today is not really about what happened, but I think it's more about we need to understand that the interconnectedness of Indian society, our values, our diversity, where we accept each other's interpretation of our motherland, you know, endearing stories about our society, our family, our ancestors, even ourselves, that we can truly understand the many dimensions of an urban Indian identity. The world is waiting for us, for each of us Indians, to express the brilliance of our history, culture, and diversity. From the times of Manu, to the Mauryan and Gupta's empire, to the legacy of Mughals, to the British Empire, to India's independence and her struggle to become the country that it is today, each and every aspect is quintessentially Indian. There is no one single definition of India. The only real definition is that we are citizens of a multidimensional historic country. As Indians, the evolution of India is so broad that it can encompass more than one definition. From science and technology, liberal arts, innovation, entrepreneurship, the story of India is far from over. In fact, it has only started. It has only begun. With this historic backdrop, we are at the cusp of developing to a developing to a developed nation. And it is only around the corner. It may be a couple of years, a couple of decades when we are going to be a developed nation. Let 75 years of Amrit Mahotsav be not only the celebration of our past, but a strong vision to a global power, not merely in terms of resources, but also known for human values and the dictum, the entire world is our family. Vasudhaiv Kutumbakam. Thank you. Dhanyavaad.
Thank you so much, sir, for your inspiring address and setting the tone of today's program. Thank you, sir, for a trip down the memory lane of India's rich culture and heritage and for keeping the spirit of patriotism high in all of us. Thank you so much, sir, to motivate us with your words of encouragement and wisdom. Thank you, sir. So moving forward, now I would like to invite Ms. Swapna Little, who is an author and historian with a specialization in the history of Delhi. She is closely involved in the movement to preserve heritage moments in sites, and she is currently the convener of the Delhi chapter of the Indian National Trust for Arts and Cultural Heritage. Ma'am always seeks to raise awareness about the city's historical developments through her writing, heritage walks, lectures, and social media. Some of her popular works are Chandni Chowk, The Mughal City of Old City, Old Delhi, that draws upon a variety of sources such as accounts of Mughal court narratives, travelers, memories, poetry, newspapers, and government documents to paint a vivid and dynamic panorama of city from its the inception to recent times. It's really great, ma'am, to have with us you today. With these words, I would like to invite you, ma'am. Over to you. And sorry for my apologies for the inconvenience, because one call was coming in between. So we welcome you, ma'am. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Anjali ma'am and Manpreet ma'am and VC Professor Dr. Mahesh Verma, my fellow speakers and all other participants who are listening in. And when I thought about this talk, I thought evolution of India pre and post independence. I'm sure most of my other speakers will also be talking about India. I think VC sir really summed up so much in his very, very brief address. So I think I'm going to connect this with Delhi, because my interest is Delhi and you all are a university that is preeminently a Delhi-based university, linked very intimately, even in your very name, you are with Indraprastha, in your very name, you are linked to an ancient Delhi. So in very few words, I want to bring out how Delhi really represents some of the aspects which are applicable to India as a whole. If you look at Delhi, from ancient times, it was on a very ancient trade route, the Uttar Path. The Uttar Path is what linked different parts of India. It linked India's trade and pilgrimage routes to the other parts of the world also. We think that we are a very globalized, we live in a very globalized times, but these ancient connections were there from earlier times as well. And Delhi being on such one of these important routes, the Uttarpath, one of the branches of the Uttarpath, has always had people passing through it. So even when it was not a capital, it has had the exchange of ideas, the coming and going of people. In fact, it was because of this importance as an important location, an important center on this trade route, that the Emperor Ashoka actually wrote one of his rock edicts over here, which you can see in what is today called East of Kailash. You can see the Ashokan inscription there. So that has been the importance of Delhi even before it became a capital. And then, of course, we have from the traditional our traditional legends, and you have the story of Indraprastha, where it is believed that this was really the capital of the Pandavas, and it is no less than Akbar and his historian Abul Fazl, who actually, when tracing the history of Delhi back to ancient times, links it to Indraprastha and gives it that sort of aura of power, which the Mughals believed in, and the Mughals believed that they were inheritors of that power. So the idea of this exchange of people, and of course, people coming in, it's not always that they came in peace. So initially, very often you have had conquerors coming in also. And some of them, while they conquered and left, they were invaders, they invaded and left. There were many conquerors who made it their home and became the rulers of the land and ceased to act as outsiders. They became an integral part of the land. And that is the other aspect of Delhi's history, which makes it actually a part of India's, which is very akin to other India as a whole also, that you have had people coming in, you have had other ethnicities coming in, you have had people from outside coming in, but making it their home and bringing with them their, whether it is their language or it is their religion or it is their literature, it is their ways of eating that they bring in, and they enrich the culture of not only the city, but of the country as a whole. So these are events that take place at a national level. They are very much evident in the history of the city as well. If you look at, you keep going, and Delhi, of course, from the early 13th century or so, becomes the capital of an expanding empire, which from your school history textbooks, I'm sure you will remember as the Delhi Sultanate. And the Delhi Sultanate, it becomes a capital, and that's where this aura of power really grows. And even though the Mughals move the capital out, that aura of power does not diminish. And again, it is the place, because of the mingling of the populations, because of the mingling of different intellectual, cultural traditions, that new developments take place. We know that one name that is associated with the musical tradition, for instance, is Amir Khusro. And the development of Indian classical music to a large extent is associated with this kind of mingling of cultures that takes place. The development of language, the development of the evolution of language, and the development of Urdu, for instance, also takes place in this kind of milieu. But you must realize that there have been many other kinds of, Indian culture has always been open to new influences, and adaptability, change, accepting things from outside, making it their own, is a big part of that culture. Some of the foods, for instance, that we consider very much a part of Indian cuisine. Can you imagine Indian cuisine without potatoes and tomatoes and mirchi, chilies? These have all come from outside. These were new world foods which were not in use until they were discovered in the Americas. So, adapting from outside, learning from outside, making it your own is very much a part of that culture, which you see in Delhi, which you see in India as a whole. In Delhi specifically, also, we have seen that people, whether it is rulers or it is the more common people, have always seen themselves as inheritors of this long history. It's not only that there is a long history and it's a multicultural history, but people have been aware of it also. And therefore, for instance, when Shah Jahan decided in 1639 that he wanted to build a new capital city and he wanted to move it from Agra, he builds it in Delhi, and he builds it next to Nigambodh Ghat. Nigambodh Ghat was a very ancient site in Delhi. It was associated with very sacred traditions, which said that Brahma had a dip in the waters of the Yamuna at that point and regained his memory of the Ved, which he had lost. The Ved is also Nigam, and Nigambodh, he got a memory of the Veds back again. So it is that sacred site that Shah Jahan picked to found his new city. And this is drawing on the old traditions of the city, drawing on the ancient significance of the city to found your own capital, that shows us how aware rulers of the time were of the traditions of India, the traditions of Delhi that they were drawing on for their own times. And this is an impulse that you can actually see even in the modern period under British rule, because even British rule, and this was in response to the Indian national movement which was growing in the early 20th century. The national movement had grown very strong, and the British needed to respond to that. And their way of responding to that was to give in to what they perceived as an Indian sentiment, which was to move the capital to Delhi. And when they moved the capital to Delhi and they made a new capital, which was New Delhi, they also kept in mind the very much so the past that was Delhi, the past that was the Indian past that was Delhi, not their own past. Even they as alien rulers, and they were alien rulers because they still went back home. Even then, many of the revenues of India were going towards the benefits of the ruling nation, which was Britain at that time. So this, even though this was happening, they still had to give in to Indian sentiment, and they moved the capital to Delhi. And keeping in mind an idea that they wanted to appeal to Indian sentiment, look at how they place the capital. Rajpath, which we see today, Rajpath is exactly parallel to Chandni Chowk. There is a straight line that can be drawn from Vijay Chowk to Jama Masjid. There is a straight line, which is Rajpath, runs from Rashtrapati Bhavan to Purana Kila. So the rulers of Delhi, even the British rulers of Delhi, have always seen the past of an imagined India as being important, as a legacy that they also have to acknowledge. I will, of course, leave our other speakers, who will, I'm sure, talk about the post-independence period, but in some more detail. But I must just end by saying that these are the legacies that we take forward today, because we can't go forward without keeping in mind all the past that we have come through. The past that is a multicultural past, a past where even today there are many, many different kinds of people from different parts, particularly of the country and the world, who come to Delhi and who make it their home. And it's their traditions also which become the traditions of us in Delhi. So we have new festivals that are important, new holidays, all these things. These are making Delhi, but it's not a new tradition. This is a part of our legacy that we welcome people, we make them at home, and they make Delhi their home, and they contribute to the image of Delhi, to the culture of Delhi, which we all ultimately end up enjoying. Think of the new changes we see in foods, for instance. So all this is very much part of our shared legacy of the city, of the country, and this is how we can move forward in the post-independence period. And 75 years after independence is a good way to look back at that period and say how far we have come and what a rich legacy we have. Thank you so very much. And Thank you very much, ma'am, for allowing me this time to speak. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thanks a lot for sharing your knowledgeable and inspiring experiences with us. It's a privilege for us to hear your wise words. And also thank you for sharing the culture of Delhi with us. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
So moving further, we are pleased to have Lieutenant General Govind Singh Chandel with us, who is an astute and reserve-oriented general with almost 40 years of selfless service to the nation. It's a proud privilege to welcome you, sir. Sir belongs to the main fighting force of the Indian Army, the infantry. Moreover, sir is also awardee of Ati Vishisht Seva Medal and Yudh Seva Medal. He is known for he is well known for his hard work, team building, training and development, and also for planning and development. Sir was Director General of Rashtriya Rifles in 2015 to 2017, which was the largest counter-terrorist force of the world with a force of approximate 85,000 troops. Sir was also Corps Commander in 2014 to 2015 on border with China with approximate 50,000 troops under his command in trying the operational conditions. It's indeed a great pleasure and honor to invite Lieutenant General Govind Singh Chandel to please share your journey in army in independent India with us. So we welcome you, sir. Over to you. Over to you, sir. Vinny, just see, sir is want to speak.
So now you're unmuted.
Yes, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
First of all, very good afternoon to you all, ladies and gentlemen, in particular, Padma Shri Professor Dr. Mahesh Verma, the Vice Chancellor of Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University, Dr. Manpreet Kang, the Director of Student Welfare, fellow panelists, and dear friends. Before I come on to the topic as such, my experience or journey in Army in India, independent India, I would like to flag certain issues as regards the role of Indian Army in the nation building. The armed forces epitomize the ideals of service, sacrifice, patriotism, and our country's composite culture. India got its independence in 47. However, India's armed forces were organized and operationalized well before this, having fought in the World War I and World War II and having gained a very rich experience. This gave the Indian Army a very high level of professionalism. One of the British general, Lord Wavell, in his words, he says, "The stability of the Indian Army may perhaps be the deciding factor in the future of India." Indeed, very professed words. Regarding the professionalism in the Indian context, Indian Army, the military professionalism was defined by Samuel Huntington in 1957 to comprise of three main corporates, that is the expertise, the responsibility, and the corporateness of a sense of belonging. The core values of the Indian Army are the Naam, Namak, and Nishan, which means Naam, a sense of pride in oneself, his unit, and his nation. And this is thus related to the expertise. Namak being the worth of one's salt, which translates into corporateness or a sense of belonging to the organization. And finally, the Nishan means dedication to the flag, which translates into responsibility. The 21st century looks towards security, justice, economic development, and the democratic polity as the three pillars of the nation building. security comes first in this pecking order because of the other three pillars function effectively only if the security threshold of the nation, both internal as well as external, which remains intact. And this in turn facilitates the smooth functioning of democracy and brings in its wake social justice and economic development. While all instruments of national power have been contributing towards nation's well-being, the Indian Armed Forces in particular, the Indian Army, have played a very vital role in nation building. Through their contribution towards overall development of the nation has been crucial and yet more indirect. And this is so because they have never been directly engaged in the developmental activities, except in the disturbed areas of Jammu and Kashmir and now Ladakh, as also the northeastern states of our country. Thus, strongly retaining the professionalism part of the army. Therefore, the Indian Army's role has been more of a protector and enabler in the nation building. At the time of partition, immediately, and the creation of the two nations, the impartiality and professionalism demonstrated by the army led to thousands of lives being saved and some order being restored during unprecedented violence, accompanying events that shook the very core of the subcontinent. Immediately after independence in 1947 and 48, it was followed by raiders and troops from Pakistan in our state of Jammu and Kashmir. The army played a stellar role in successfully defending Kashmir and reclaiming major part of it. Had it not been for the orders to stop, the march would have been further, and what we have, POK, Muzaffarabad and all, would have been with us, and the history of Kashmir and the present day situation in Kashmir would have been totally different. As regards the territorial consolidation of the country, in 1961, the army liberated Goa, Daman and Diu, thus eliminating the last symbolism of the colonialism that the subcontinent had witnessed. As regards the war which the country has fought, besides 1947-48, the wars of 1962 with China, 1965 with Pakistan, and 1971 with Pakistan with the creation of Bangladesh, as also the limited war in Kargil in 1999. These wars were essentially fought to protect our territorial integrity while also protecting the national interests. Thus, the armed forces were baptized with fire and brew right from the beginning and being extremely professional and well-lit organization. What about the internal security? The armed forces are employed in internal security since 1950s to maintain the sovereignty and integrity of the country. There have been many successes in what can be termed as a nation-building effort. Be it Tripura, which is well governed now and fully integrated state, Mizoram, which also fought back, and now for many years it has been in the mainstream national fold. The insurgency in Punjab was successfully dealt and is again one of the vibrant states of our country. Kashmir had a series of successful events, initially elections, and now after the revocation of Article 370, the situation is totally different and the peace is returning. It's a matter of time that the people of Kashmir realize that the integration and the development of the state can take place only with this total involvement of the people, as the government of India is doing every bit that is possible. As regards the overseas peace initiatives by Indian Army on behalf of the government of India, India has been a regular contributor to the UN peacekeeping missions, having contributed over 1 lakh troops in various operations and various nations across all continents. In 1971, the Indian Armed Forces ably supported the valiant people of East Pakistan, leading to the creation of Bangladesh. On request, Indian Armed Forces intervened in Maldives in 1988 to rescue President Gayoom from a coup attempt and restored democracy there. Indian peacekeeping forces assisted peace operations in Sri Lanka, unmindful of the heavy cost which they paid. As regards disaster management and humanitarian relief, the Indian Army and the armed forces have always been in the forefront, be it earthquake, floods, or man-made disaster. Our territorial army units have contributed immensely to afforestation initiatives and have transformed large swaths of land which have been ravaged by natural and man-made disasters. In the eco-sensitive zone of Siachen, we have taken initiative to dispose of the waste which has been created since the commencement of the conflict therein. As regards upholding the core national values, firstly, the nourishing democracy, Indian defense disciplines have contributed significantly to nourish the democracy by its high standards of professionalism, dedication to duty, and exemplary norms of discipline. Indian Defense Forces are the last resort in dealing with civil strife when it goes beyond the capability of the other instruments of the state available to the government. The impartial face of army is evident while countering sectarian clashes, terrorism, or insurgency in any part of the country. As a symbol of integration, the armed forces have been in the forefront, secular through turbulent times faced by the country, and has fostered the spirit of one India like no other organ of the state. Armed forces also play an important role in national character building. A large number of government initiatives to include the Digital India, Swachh Bharat, and Make in India. As regards infrastructure development in the remote area, the Border Road Organization or the Ministry of Defense had played a significant contribution and stellar role in connecting the far-flung areas to the mainland. As regards in the remote area, the disturbed areas, the Army has undertaken various military civic action projects like repair and construction of roads and bridges, installation of micro hydro projects, running of schools and vocational training center in the remote areas, and empowering the tribal people in those remote areas. Construction of modern villages, and these projects provide employment opportunity to the people as also a stable platform for the civil governance to reassess itself. And National Cadet Corps has been playing and engaged in a very important role of grooming our youth and imbibing them with the qualities of discipline, selfless service, and the spirit of nationalism. As regards contribution to the sports and adventure activities, our army has played a very leading role, and the number of medals in the Olympics and the Asian Games have been by the army personnel. And as regards after leaving the army, the personal ex-servicemen, they also contribute immensely towards our social life and social security. Be that as it may, the nation-building activities of army, but we as a professional army, we have to evolve ourselves continuously to meet our future emerging challenges. As regards the geopolitical situation, what is happening in the Middle East, West, and right on our northern borders and our neighboring areas in South China Sea, Asia Pacific, the government of India has been playing a very important role, and in that, army has been an important instrument. We also look at the emerging threat on our northern borders and West and the pollution. Thus, the Indian Armed Forces are very well prepared for the 2.5 front, that is with the our western neighbor, our northern neighbor, and the internal disturbance which they are capable of creating. The fourth generation warfare or hybrid warfare is already on. A major challenge which is emerging, which possesses or rather poses threats which are likely to be increasingly employed by renegade states as also the non-state actors. conflict will also increasingly present us with the hybrid threats, combining conventional, irregular, and the high-end asymmetric threat. In the same time and space, terrorism, therefore, including its various manifestations, will continue to invite focused attention, requiring earnest cooperation amongst various organs of the state as also between nations to deal with them effectively. Net-centric operations. The recent advances in the information technology have significantly transformed the battle space and the way the combat power can be generated effectively, linking of the war-fighting enterprise. It is characterized by the ability of the geographically displaced forces to create a high level of shared battle space, awareness enabling self, and synchronization to achieve commander's intent. Before I share my experience in Army, I would also like to highlight a few points here. If the security of India is at risk in many senses because of the internal dynamics of the South Asian political scenario, the resultant continued instability that all sides pose a very serious threat to the security of the nation, whose mechanism of governance are severely strained in the face of these challenges. The 21st century India has challenges in the form of terrorism, population migration, narco-terrorism, and extremist ideology. It also establishes that dictatorial regimes are rejected by the people and they are unable to provide satisfaction with respect to any of the four pillars of nation building. The primary role of military is to defend the country against all internal and external threats. It is trained, organized, and equipped accordingly. The military has also contributed in a major way to development of core values of liberty, equality, promoting fraternity to assure dignity to our people. The Indian Defense Forces truly represent the maxim of unity in diversity. The military will continue to be a professional, apolitical, secular, disciplined, and motivated force, which will provide secure conditions and support the nation's quest to develop and achieve peace and prosperity by its citizens. However, it has to be constantly evolving and ensuring that the modern concepts of military training and military education are exploited to the best to meet its professional needs and future challenges posed by a changing world. Now, coming to my journey in Army, because I did not wish to bore our listeners and the August gathering with what I did in the Army, but briefly I will just cover that having been commissioned as second lieutenant in the Army in 1978, post the training period in the infantry, that is the main fighting force of Indian Army, I was commissioned in the Bihar Regiment. Honored to be part of the fourth largest army of the world, a volunteer army, unlike the army of the USA and China. 39 years of eventful journey has been a memorable experience. Served in almost all parts of the country, east to west, north to south, and particularly Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh, more than 3 tenures. And one got to know and see one's own country and experience their traditions, their way of life, their culture, and all other aspects related to it. Army is a big family, and unit in particular is a very close-knit family, which takes care of all aspects, not only while you're in service, but also while one hangs one's boots and joins the CV streets. This is truly national integration. No religion, no caste, no regional dividing lines. There's a Sarv Dham Sthal for puja by all sects under the same roof. Like me being from Bihar Regiment, we have a mandir in our units and we have a church side by side. All officers go to the mandir first and thereafter they shift just few yards to the left or right to attend the church service. I hardly got to know during all the service of mine, particularly while serving the unit, anybody is caste or any other differences. We all ate from the same cookhouse, which we call langar, and quite a few times from the same plate also, particularly when serving in field areas. One particular experience which I have as a commanding officer of my battalion 12 Bihar, which I was commanded on the Pir Panjal ranges in the Kashmir Valley from 1997 to 1999, is very, very fresh in my mind, and it will always remain so. It was a task to be carried out across the line of control, which was in a army terminology, it's called the raid, but popularly known as surgical strike, which of late we saw in the aftermath of Uri. As a commanding officer, our battalion was to carry out a task with our Ghatak platoon and associated troops across the line of control in the Pir Panjal range, with height ranging about 12,500 feet. It is the month of November. There are about 3 feet of standing snow, a task which my boys had practiced earlier. And when the day of reckoning came, initially it was decided to be 7th of November, but that day it was a very heavy snow, so it was postponed by 2 days. And on 9th of November, with 3 feet plus a snow in that area, we were to carry out this task. I will not go into the nitty-gritty and details of the task. Suffice it to say that all actions taken, and when finally all those boys who were to go across the line of control, which included 3 officers and about 40 odd men, before they went, I got them into an enclosed space so that I can speak to them. And this task, as you know, it across the line of control, there is an enemy who is equally trained and professional. He's got his weapons, and any army or any armed personnel, self-defense or in action, which is against him, he is very much likely to take all action that is possible. To the extent of all these 40 men could have given or made the supreme sacrifice. So they all were prepared, highly motivated. And when I got them in the enclosed space and I wanted to speak to them, 40 of them, and they adjusted their position in a manner that we could all have eye-to-eye contact. And in those few moments, nothing was said, nothing was spoken. I only glanced from left to right and right to left, looking into the eyes of each one of them. And I found that kind of commitment, the kind of response, that is the very prized moment and memory in my heart. Each one of them prepared to go to the extent of making the supreme sacrifice for the cause of the nation. And that was the most precious moment of my life. We carried out this raid very successfully. We destroyed Pakistani post. We killed their 17 soldiers. We brought their large number of weapons, which are still kept in the battalion as a war trophy. However, in this process, we paid a very heavy price of having lost one officer, Captain Gurjinder Singh Suri. He was awarded Mahavir Chakra posthumously. One Sipahi Manoj Kumar Singh, who was awarded Veer Chakra posthumously, and Sipahi Virinder Kumar Singh and Lance Nayak Virinder Singh. The heavy price of 4 lives lost, we made, but then we made sure the task given, which was successful. So in this whole process, the experience of a soldier, because life is something which one cannot give, but here on the orders of his commanding officer, men are prepared to make the supreme sacrifice, which does not happen in any profession. And no commanding officer, or rather no profession, can demand of that. So it was a very, very rich experience and those memorable moments. And this is just one incident. There are a number of other incidents in various units. Whenever a task is given, it is carried out. And I'm proud to say that I belong to this Bihar regiment, which is also the Galwan ke Balwan. Recently, the Galwan incident in Eastern Ladakh happened by one of the Bihar battalion, and they made the supreme sacrifice, about 20 soldiers in that incident. and these kind of things from time to time are ordered and executed. And I can say with all authority at my disposal and with all the honesty that our soldier, Indian soldiers, are the best soldier in the world anyway. They will respond provided they are led well. And they have proved it not once, every time. Kargil operations, we paid supreme sacrifice, but we regained all the heights. And if orders were to the extent that we should gain more than what we had lost, that could have also been done. But it was a very conscious decision by the government of that time. In the end, I can only say that with my nearly 39 years of experience in the army and the vibrant India, I am sanguine that with a lot of conviction, I am saying, I can assure the August gathering on behalf of the all armed forces, and that armed forces will continue to be the mainstay of our national power because of protected lead in delivering on issues which contribute towards nation building, not merely by words, but through our genuine deeds. Jai Hind, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot for sharing your experiences of Indian Army and also for giving an excellent coverage on what goes behind attaining the freedom and independence. And we all enjoy. And sir, thank you very much for your wise insights too. It's a privilege for all of us to hear your wise words. Thank you so much, sir. So moving forward, I would like to invite Dr. Rizwan Kaiser, who is working as professor in Department of History and Culture at Jamia Millia Islamia. Sir has completed his MPhil and PhD from Center for Historical Studies, JNU. His research interest includes history of Indian national movement, Gandhian politics, Muslim identities in colonial India, politics of language in colonial and post-colonial India. He has a rich teaching experience of more than 30 years. During his career, sir has been assigned a number of important positions like sir is elected as academic council at Jamia Millia Islamia from 2009 to 2012. He was director of Center for Study of Comparative Religions and Civilizations from 2012 to 2014. Professor Rizwan was the head of Department of History and Culture, Jamia Millia Islamia from 2014 to 2017. We welcome you, sir. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Anjali Shaukeen, for speaking very kind words for me. But before I make my formal presentation, I think a word of gratitude to all the people responsible for my being here. First of all, Padma Shri, Professor Mahesh Verma ji as Vice Chancellor of Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University. Then we have, Professor Manpreet Kaur Kang for being very kind to extend this invitation to me. And above all, Professor Queenie Singh, who contacted me and asked me to join the kind of program that you all had worked on to speak on like the theme that is very clearly identified, evolution of India pre and post independence. So in a way, my job as a student of history, it cuts both ways. In a way, I would be troubling into the past, and I would also be traveling in the contemporary. In a way, as a student of history, job is not only to look back into the past, but our job is also to, in a way, identify the kind of developments which are taking place in the contemporary, because there is a direct symbiotic relationship, very, very organic relationship between the past and the contemporary. What happened then, what is happening now, must find a kind of a synchronization in order to take the journey forward. Seen in this perspective, we realize that, 75 years long journey of India as a sovereign nation, and then more than about 150 years of India as a colony of the British Empire, whether under the British East India Company or the British Crown, irrespective of the nomenclature of the company and the crown, what all happened there and how did we evolve and how did we become sovereign and what has been the sovereign journey of India as a country, as a nation, all that I would touch upon. And I'm given to understand, and I think I noticed this is the unsaid code that every speaker has 15 minutes to himself or herself. This is what Dr. Swapna Liddell did, and so did Lieutenant General Chandel Saab. At the max, I think 15 to 20 minutes, so stretching another 5 minutes.
Yes, sir, I would like to interrupt that, Ma'am Swapna Liddell was in a bit of a hurry. Otherwise, you can take half an hour, at your convenience.
No, fair enough, but let me make it 20 to 25 minutes.
Right. Whatever you feel, right.
That would be in keeping with other speakers. Otherwise, it will be seen as a kind of taking advantage of being the last speaker. So I will avoid that. So let us look at who are we as people, and how do we evolve into a nation. In the course of this journey, then how do we become sovereign nation? These are the three points that I would like to touch upon. Professor Mahesh Verma did refer to in his inaugural address, the rebellion of 1857. I think one of the finest moments in India's history, even though a little violent, but one of the finest moments from two, three distinct point of view. Number one, that on a quite a larger scale, I wouldn't say pan-Indian scale, but on quite a larger scale, people had started becoming acutely aware of their life as subject people of the company. Not just from the Battle of Plassey, but into several battles and several acts of manipulation and several acts of deceit and several acts of exploitation, in a way had made them fully conscious. One would say that the rebellion of 1857 was not necessarily born out of any great ideological construction. But the very fact that rebellion of 1857 was born out of realization, if not construction, and the realization of having been subjected to all kinds of exploitation, economic in particular, political subjugation for no doubt being there, but also too much of cultural interference, too much of undermining the kind of intellectual, philosophical, another kind of heritage that India had been able to accumulate over the centuries and millennia. Everything was brought under assault, ideological assault, at the hands of the rulers and at the hands of the missionaries and at the hands of the Orientalists. They try to convey an impression that these Orientalists were helping Indians to rediscover their past, as if Indians had at any point of time lost any sense of history, that they needed to be told that this is what your history was like. And by doing this, what the British were trying to tell, that, well, that is how we will help you enter an era, what they call Renaissance. And I'm sure as students of history, we all are acutely aware, Renaissance presupposes that there was a dark age. And I, again, as a student of history, would like to wonder, when was there any dark age in India's long historical continuity? Indians were repeatedly told that the British had come to India to civilize us. as if there was lack of elements of civilization among Indians. And when I say among Indians, I say across the board. Geographical length and breadth, the cultural diversity, the social existence of variety of people in terms of faith, language, literature, food, dress, and whatever. It was in this context that one would say that it was too much of hyperbole on the part of the British to think that they had come to civilize us. So in a way, they were operating on paradoxicality. On the one hand, they were saying that, well, India had a great, you know, accomplishment, but in the past, in the distant past, in between, they had fallen on bad days, and that those, you know, like falling in the bad days constituted the kind of dark age. And here the British had arrived to usher Indians into an era of renaissance. And the renaissance leading to the larger colonial project of white man's burden, civilizing Indians. And here I'm reminded of a very interesting episode that happened in the life of an eminent nationalist of his time. Many of you would remember his name, Surendranath Banerjee. Early nationalist who was into working out a kind of a worldview in order to resist the colonial rule. It was sometime in 1880s, 88, 87, 88, he had the opportunity of addressing Oxford Union in England. And in the course of his speech, he happened to remark that, well, you all seem to suggest that you have come to India to civilize us. And then he said, sorry, we don't accept it and we don't agree with that, for the simple reason that India has been a civilized nation for a very, very long time. India was able to make great accomplishment in the field of state institutions, philosophy, art, literature, whatever. And as a matter of fact, India was civilized at a time when your forefathers, addressing the white crowd in the Oxford Union Hall, when your forefathers were roaming in tree box in jungles. Imagine a person like Surendranath Banerjee addressing an entirely European crowd, the British crowd, and telling them that your half-baked colonial agenda of civilizing Indians was rejected, because India had already experienced civilizational journey for a very, very long time. He never made any distinction that the civilization journey belonged only to ancient and medieval was empty, or it's a dark age. The colonial historiography repeatedly wanted to emphasize this. It was rejected by Surendranath Banerjee. So the journey is interesting. Journey is interesting. Indian religions were majorly two. Hinduism and Islam were under attack by colonial writers. They particularly targeted Bengalis, saying that they worship female goddesses and therefore they were quite effeminate in their character. Whichever way you look at it, then you realize that the Indian civilizational world was under attack. Religious practices were under attack. Their social organizations were critiqued. It was a journey from here that people began to rediscover themselves. not necessarily reading to Renaissance, because that was a colonial agenda, but in a way, people wanted to rediscover themselves with the help of their scriptures, with the help of their cultural traditions, with the help of many such things. And in a way, you realize, in the course of it, they succeeded in achieving, one, that they kept the cultural world largely autonomous of the colonial interference. And because of this, they were to discover themselves. So this is the kind of journey that we have. Coming back to 1857, turning kind of a turning point in India's history. One of the finest hours of the collaborative effort between Hindus and Muslims to save India. Three examples that I would like to give you in order to understand. Lieutenant General Chandel Sahib is there. The Bengal Army, which was stationed in Meerut, and when soldiers of the Bengal Army decided to march to Delhi, they mostly consisted of, and with due apology to Chandel Sahib, majority of them came from the high caste background. They were Rajputs, they were Brahmins, they were other, not that I particularly believe in caste system, but then only to identify. Because Bengal Army largely consisted of people from such background. When they decided to march on Delhi, whom did they go first to? They went to Bahadur Shah Zafar. Bahadur Shah Zafar, who was still seen as Bashaw of Hindustan. Even though his powers were considerably limited, and yet symbolically they thought that here was someone who would lead these soldiers in their rebellion. With an initial reluctance shown by Bahadur Shah Zafar, he decided to provide leadership to the whole rebellion, particularly in Delhi. And after this, rebel leaders, wherever they happened to be, they all made public declaration of accepting Bahadur Shah Zafar as Badshah of Hindustan. Be that Jhansi Ki Rani, Nana Sahib, Tantiya Tope, Begum Hazrat Mahal from Lucknow, or wherever. Only if soldiers were to believe in the colonial historiography of good Muslims and bad Muslims, they would not have come to Bahadur Shah Zafar. Number two example that I'd like to see, how India was evolving as a nation in the course of the rebellion. Though, I mean, the nation making of a nation is a long drawn out process that takes longer. But at that point in time, in the course of the rebellion, fell the Muslim festival of Eid al-Zuha, where they perform animal sacrifice. Very interesting farman that Bahadur Shah Zafar issued, that in his realm, nobody must be found sacrificing a cow. If anybody would be found sacrificing a cow, would be meted out penal punishment. That is punishment by death. That's the kind of a farman that was issued by Bahadur Shah Zafar. In deference to the wishes of the Hindu population of Israel, soldiers and everybody, that was the kind of a tradition that was maintained by Mughals. Exceptions apart, to respect religio-cultural traditions of the larger society. And in the context of 1857, on the occasion of Bakrid, one person who was a collaborator of one of the British soldier, he sacrificed a cow and he was arrested. That's the second example that I would like to share with you. The third example, that ulema, that the Muslim religious leaders had given a call for jihad, and they put a poster on the doors of Jama Masjid inviting people to mount jihad against the British. The British tried to play cunning, and the next day they put up a poster saying that how could you mount a jihad against us? We are also believers and Ahle Kitab because we have the Bible. The next day ulema put up, and they said, no, the British said that if at all you should mount jihad against anybody, you should mount jihad against Hindus. The next day ulema put up another poster saying Hindus are our brothers, and this call for jihad is for Hindus and Muslims together. And this call for jihad is against you because you have come to our country and you have destroyed it. You have looted it inside out, and therefore this jihad is against you. One more example I would like to share with you. Khan Bahadur Khan, in the region of Rohilkhand, particularly Bareilly, was able to establish a rebel regime. And his Diwan was Shobha Ram. When the procession was taken out in town, in order to let the world know, here was a regime, a rebel regime. All kinds of people joined, and two kinds of flag were, you know, moving along with the procession. One was the Islamic flag. Another was a Hindu flag with the insignia of sun god, Surya Devta, on a saffron flag. So you have Islamic flag and you have Hindu flag blending together in the course of the march in Bareilly. It is recorded that the British had spared some 50,000 rupees to foment trouble in the region of Bareilly by bribing people to create Hindu-Muslim trouble, and they failed. In other words, 1857 turns out to be the finest moment in the long history of India and Indian people's emergence as a nation, based on capitalizing on each other's strength, mutuality of respect and camaraderie, the political collaboration, and not necessarily buying into the colonial historiographical logic of one being in perpetual conflict with another. As a matter of fact, this was no question of conflict. As a matter of fact, it was a question of collaboration between the two. It should not surprise us that after 1857, brutally suppressed, Indians on a large scale or in any large scale manner did not try to rise in rebellion. Instead, they started getting into construction of an ideological frame, mobilization of certain kind of people to participate in the political process in order to challenge the colonial rule. Now they needed to challenge the colonial rule ideologically and politically, not necessarily in the manner of rebellion. It should not surprise that Indian National Congress comes into being. Not many of us would know, or perhaps would know, but not lay that kind of an emphasis. The first president of Indian National Congress, Vomesh Chandra Banerjee, was a Christian by faith. We have Dada Bhai Noroji, a Parsi. We have Badruddin Tayyabji, a Muslim. We have large number of, you know, like people like Lokmanya Tilak, Gopal Krishna Gokhale, Surendranath Banerjee, how all these people come together in order to work out a mechanism to critique the colonial state and make demands for a space for Indians in institutions of governance, be that civil services, police, or for that matter, army. On the merit of it, expansion of democratic institutions, construction and reinforcement of technical institutions for the training of Indians so that they could find gainful employment after having been educated in these modern institutions of learning. And above all, they critique the colonial government for passing off India's wealth for the benefit of England. What is the famous theory that was worked out by Dada Bhai Noroji, the drain of wealth? It is this journey which acquires a new dimension by the time we hit the 20th century. No people realize that such kind of mendicancy, petitions, and other such public representation wasn't really bearing fruit. And we have emergence of a new component in Indian politics, what is famously known as the extremist phase of Indian politics. Whether moderate or whether extremist, the fact remains that they both were providing wonderful critique of the colonial government. And then you realize, in a way, it was a kind of an indication of Indians having come of age. Now they were becoming conscious of emerging as a nation. None of us should be surprised if I were to use the expression of Surendranath Banerjee, that India was a nation in the making. That at that point in time, India had not really emerged as a nation, but it was a nation in the making. It is this journey which was in a way taken over and then carried forward by the leadership of Mahatma Gandhi. Mahatma Gandhi, if one was to look at Mahatma Gandhi's entire ideological construction and the political campaign that he launched, I'm sure many of us present here must have had the opportunity of reading the Hind Swaraj, one of the finest early document prepared by Gandhi way back in 1909. He clearly identified that Indians were lacking in confidence and courage. With the help of Hind Swaraj, Gandhi wanted to restore that critical salt of confidence in the hearts and minds of Indians. When he critiqued every single institution brought by the West, brought by the colonial masters. Gandhi was still not in India. He was operating in South Africa, and yet, as an Indian, his heart was here. And he worked out he laid out the ideological plan of critiquing every single colonial institution so that Indians would have an opportunity to rework out those institutions, be that the institution of knowledge, legal institution, political institution, and whatever that we had. When Mahatma Gandhi came to India in 1915, he had already been exposed to dealing with multiplicity of people from such diverse background in terms of religion, region, language, culture. In a way, Gandhi knew how to harmonize diversity and use this diversity as a source of his strength in the course of his mobilization campaign on Indian soil. Starting from Champaran to the launch of non-cooperation Khilafat movement. And he said that it is this diversity with the help of which a new India could be reborn. That India which would be reclaimed by everyone. Hindus, Muslims, Christians, Parsis, tribals, women, Dalits. It is this that Gandhi sustained all through the 20s and 30s. In some cases directly and in some cases indirectly, Gandhi wanted to, you know, like empower sections of the society which so far have been on the margins of it. And I would particularly talk about women and Dalits. Gandhi, with the help of his politics, Satyagraha and other form of politics, he created a space for women. He did not create any condition where families would break, but families would survive with as much dignity, but women would also acquire personality of their own. They would participate in dharna and go back home. They would still, you know, make bonfire of things and still retain their connection with the families. Gandhi understood that Indian society is still happened to be based on certain traditional values. And yet from within that tradition, new India needed to be born. New India needed to be forged. It is this that Gandhi was trying to do. It is this that Gandhi was trying to do in the course of his campaign. He brought Hindus and Muslims together. He knew that these together would produce the kind of strength that was the need of the hour. With the help of his Satyagraha and Ahimsa, in a way he filled the hearts and minds of Indians with pride and confidence. This journey, which was carried right up to 1942, Quit India movement. But he's just not the only one. There are many others. And we all, when we remember 75 years of India's independence, Azadi Ke Amrit Mahotsav, large number of Indians who made sacrifices. We need to recall their services to the nation. We should recall the services of a large number of Dalit leaders, tribal leaders, women leaders, leadership from the minority communities, Muslims in particular, Sikh leadership in the region of Punjab. How do we locate them? How do we look at them working in a synergetic manner in order to forge India, which was not under the shadow of colonial rule, but out of the shadow. And we have communities coming together. Of course, unfortunate incident of the partition of India took place. The kind of bloodletting that took place, nobody should ever forget. People contributed towards this destructive politics in a variety of ways. That also we should look at in terms of evaluating it. So that we ensure in 2021 that no such thing is ever repeated. Nobody is allowed to get away with any kind of extremist politics, irrespective of the color. And then India emerging as a sovereign nation in 1947. And I think the greatest accomplishment of sovereign people, one of the finest are, is that we were able to give ourselves a constitution, one of the best, and a constitution which recognized each one of us as a sovereign being. When we celebrate 75 years of it, I think what we need to celebrate is that we have a constitution. You know, in the finest tribute that was paid to Marx was by poet Iqbal. He said something in Persian. I will use it. And then I will like to paraphrase it. About Marx, he said, Neist Paghambar, wo lekin dar baghal darat kitab. Wo paghambar nahi hai, lekin uske paas kitab hai. दर बगल यानी बगल में वो किताब रखता मार्क्स के बारे में. अगर हिंदुस्तान के बारे में हम कहें तो वी हैव एवरीवन कंट्रीब्यूटिंग बट वी हैव बाबा साहेब अंबेडकर आल्सो कंट्रीब्यूटिंग एंड आई वुड लाइक टू पैराफ्रेज एंड से नीस पैगंबर वो लेकिन दर बगल दारत किताब एंड दैट इज वेयर वी गेट ए बुक. That is called Constitution of India. It is the treasure house of lights in all direction. It visualizes India that India was not. It talked about gender equality that India did not have in 1947. It talked about caste equality that it did not have. Unfortunately, in matters of caste, we still do not have that. In terms of north, south, caste, religion, language, then you realize that overcoming all these difficulties, I want and I truly challenge anybody to show us a constitution which was recognized 24 Indian languages as national languages. There is no country on this earth which recognizes more than one or two languages as national language. India is an exception. And this exceptionalism was due to the constitution that we adopted on 26 January 1950, that we had 24 Indian languages as national languages. No language enjoys superiority over the other. None is considered inferior to the other. It is this that we should take pride. Look at the nuances, the nuts and bolts that the Constitution of India was able to create for governance. Look at the countries which evolved as a democracy. They evolved over a long period of time. But when India was evolving as a nation and as a democracy, by stroke of pen, it conferred equality and voting right to every single citizen, man, woman, anybody who was an adult had a voting right. Almost exceptional. When we are to evaluate 75 years of India's independence, I think it's time that we evaluate India's accomplishment in such context. That has been a great journey. But do I mean to say that there has been no difficulty? Yes, we have confronted many. We are confronting many. And we would confront many in times to come. But it is our collective strength which should give us energy and imagination to overcome in the best interest of the nation and its onward march. At the end of it, all I can say is time that as Indians, we can legitimately take pride in its journey in the last 75 years, but I think in 1947, let us look back 75 years into colonial rule and 75 years as sovereign nation. During the colonial rule, India was struggling to emerge as a nation. Now that we are a sovereign nation, let us see how best do we uphold the constitutional values in our day-to-day life. How do we maintain and uphold constitutional values in our family life? How best do we maintain gender equality within the family? That's important. How do we not, you know, like inculcate any values which are negative in the hearts and minds of our young children, boys, girls, men and women? That would be true celebration of India's, you know, like journey as a sovereign nation. With these words, once again, my gratitude to people who've been responsible for my being part of your program, everyone. And once again, I go back to Professor Queenie Singh for persistently advising me to join. And I'm very happy joining you. Thank you so much. Thank you for your patience.
Thank you so much, sir, for your enlightening talk on pre and post independence. Sir, your thought-provoking address has made us all appreciate our history as well as present. So thanks a lot, sir, for your words of wisdom. And I just want to thank our Vice Chancellor, sir. I can see sir is traveling right now, but he is hearing the talk given by you, sir. So thank you.
That's very kind of him.
Thank you, sir. So Vineet, please, can you check Dr. Naresh Vats has joined, because it's a time for the announcement of the results of essay competition, which we have organized in the morning, because he was calling me that there is a signal problem and he is not able to join. So please see if Dr. Naresh has joined.
Ma'am, sir has not joined.
Okay, so I think let me, Manpreet ma'am, then I can announce the names. What do you suggest?
Please go ahead, Anjali.
Okay, ma'am. I want to inform you that we have organized one essay competition in the morning also on the theme of Raj to Swaraj. And there were 28 entries which we received. And here is the result for that. So I'll begin with the third position. Third is Nomita Rana. Nomita Rana, are you here? Yes. If you are here, so we can see you.
She might be muted, so I don't know. So maybe you can first read out all the...
Okay, ma'am.
So if you have the titles of the essays, you could read those out. And then we can see if they can get these students,
Ma'am. It was a common talk, and the theme was Raj to Swaraj. They all have written on this theme only. So I'm putting the names. The first one is Akshita Khanna. Second one is Priyanshu Benival. And third one is Nomita Rana. So students, if you are here, so you can on your video so that we can see.
And the students, the students will be getting some cash prize or the first winner. I mean, the first essay will get 1,000, and the rest of the others can have 500. So the students might be happy to hear, because it was, you know, the amount was less when it was mentioned earlier. But the registrar, you know, discussing with him, sir said that no, let's encourage the students. So the first prize is going to be 1,000 and the second and third will get 500 each. But just a little token of appreciation and motivation for the students.
Thank you, ma'am.
So congratulations, dear students. Congratulations to all the three students, and you will be getting the certificates also. So with this, we have come to an end of the program, and I feel privileged to have the opportunity to express my gratitude. I would like to thank Honorable Vice Chancellor Sir for his constant support and guidance. I would also like to thank Registrar Sir for being the source of inspiration.
Lovely.
I also thank Ms. Swapna for the informative talk and for her kind presence. I also thank Lieutenant General Gobind Singh Chandel for sharing his experiences of Indian Army with us. I also thank Professor Rizwan for his insightful and knowledgeable talk. I also thank COF Madam for always supporting in all the endeavors. I also thank Manpreet Ma'am for continuing to be a pillar of strength and always motivating us for doing better. I also thank my colleagues Dr. Gulshan Dhamija for his unparalleled support. My sincere thanks to all the deans and directors, faculty colleagues, all officials of the university, who all participants who graced this occasion with their presence. Thanks a lot to all the students who have participated in the competition and have shown their interest in attending the program. I also thanks the Office of Directorate of Student Welfare for the smooth organization of the program. I also thanks media team for covering all the events in the public domain. I also thanks the student coordinators of the program, Vineet and Achal, who worked beyond their comfort zones. In the end, I would like to convey my sincere thanks to everyone present here for sparing their valuable time. Once again, thank you all. Jai Hind, Jai Bharat.
Thank you, Professor. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot, sir, for sparing the valuable time. Thanks a lot.